Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents The Operation by Dylan Young, narrated by Mark Peachey. Chapter 1, Tuesday the 7th of May, 2019. Twitter feed, hashtag find Katie. Leah Sandler, at Leasand3, 7th of May, 2019. Katie Leith missing for too many days, hashtag find Katie. Someone must have seen something. Stand up and be counted. God bless you, Katie Angel. Jamila the Honey, at Jamili Hun, 7th of May 2019. I hope she's safe, but all the odds are against it. Hashtag find Katie. Hate killers, hate murderers, hate kidnappers. Ken the Scooper, at Ken Scoop, 7th of May 2019. Police have told young women in Oxford to be on the lookout. Not to go anywhere alone. WTF is wrong with people. Hashtag safe streets. Hashtag find Katie. Todd Machine, at Todd Machine, 7th of May 2019. When they find who took her, they need to behead the turd. Bring it on. Hashtag find Katie. Hashtag eye for an eye. Chapter 2. Fears grow over missing nurse Katie. We'd like to hear from anyone who knows anything. Even the slightest detail could be vital. These are the desperate words of Detective Inspector Joanna Ridley as Oxford police ramp up appeals for help in the search of Katie Leith, missing since leaving a works party 4 days ago. The headline, white print on a black banner, glares up from yesterday's newspaper. A bank holiday edition lying folded on the counter of Pause for Clause that I study idly as I wait for my charge. I've seen headlines like this before. Harrowing, terrifying stories of abduction and murder. Trite phrasing that hardly touches the sleepless suffering of those closest to the victim. But when she's known to you, albeit vaguely, the words somehow take on a heightened level of vileness. I drag my eyes away as the door opens. And inbound Sid, the Labrador Rottweiler cross I'm about to take out for a walk. He's a black and tan bruiser, a handsome showstopper. His energetic greeting drives all thoughts of Katie Leith from my head as the assistant hands over the leash. Sid neither knows nor cares about missing nurses. He's keen to go. I'm with him there, so we scramble out, Sid's claws scrabbling on the linoleum as we head off. The world is a cornucopia of smells for Sid, who seems to point his snout in 100 directions at once. I have to drag him away from a couple of gateposts, but soon we're into it. We have an agreement, Sid and I. Off the leash as soon as we can. But that means no stopping until we get there. There, of course, is a park where he immediately spots a jogger on the path ahead. He stops. Curiosity aroused, tail wagging. I pull him close on the lead. Not easy since he's 35 kilos. I don't know this jogger. She's not one I've come across on this route. She's young, Lululemon from head to toe, ponytail swinging rhythmically as she approaches. Sometimes when they see Sid, they'll slow down. Occasionally they'll veer off the path, survival instincts kicking in. To give him a wide berth. Understandable given Hollywood's predilection for Rottweilers as their attack dog of choice. But though he's a boisterous dog, Sid's just sociable. He doesn't have a nasty bone in his body. He won't attack anyone unless attempting to lick someone to death qualifies as assault. He's 5 and has scars on his face, and only half a left ear where other dogs have mauled him. His previous owner thought it would be fun to put him up against the odd pit bull. People can be arseholes. This jogger, I'm glad to see, is not. She's a good judge of dogs' characters. She doesn't veer off. Instead, she smiles at me and at Sid as she passes. A transient greeting in an angel's face. He watches her go and lifts his nose to follow her scent. I ruffle the fur on his head and tell him he's a good lad, which he is. 2 months ago he would have lunged at the jogger because he didn't know any better. But I've been teaching him manners and how to socialise on our walks, which I do 3 times a week for Pause for Clause. I know, It's a cringeworthy name. But as a shelter, they do a great job rescuing the SIDS of this world. So they can call themselves whatever they like as far as I'm concerned. And they're happy for me to take Sid out because, to begin with, no one else would. He was just too much dog. But I know he's a pussycat, really. Not that I'd ever tell him that, because it would be asking for trouble, given that they're two of his favourite trigger words. When you walk dogs, you meet other dog walkers. Most of us have regular routes, so it's the same handful I normally see. Wednesdays, it's Ella, a bubbly, smiley mother of one. Saturday mornings, it's Galina, young, withdrawn, Eastern European, memorable for all the wrong reasons. But today, on a frosty Tuesday morning, it's Rob Eastman. I haven't seen him for almost a month, neither here, on a walk, nor at the hospital where he's a surgical colleague. Mid-50s, bespectacled with an unfashionable bottle brush moustache and wind-blown hair, Rob's a bit of an enigma. I've lost count of how many children he has, though he proudly peppers conversations with their names. Now he's striding towards Sid and me with a lurcher called Maisie. When we get near enough, the dogs say hello in their usual unabashed nose-to-tail manner. Rob grins.
Jacob, good morning. Cool though for May.
The sun is up and there's dew on the grass. It is, and yes, we must be mad.
Bit off your patch, aren't you?
This is Sid's neck of the woods. Rob nods.
Bloody awful about that nurse, isn't it?
Terrible. I agree.
She's just a year or two older than our Harriet. Doesn't bear thinking about.
I nod. There's suddenly an empty void in the conversation that neither of us wants to walk into. Sid ends it by barking at a terrier 100 years away. Maisie joins in. I calm Sid down with a quiet word and a hand on his head. Rob stares at the terrier, not seeing it, his thoughts elsewhere. He's dressed in an ancient waxed jacket with ripped pockets and paint-stained jeans. When I bump into him in the corridors at work, his suit and fat-stained ties are from the same dishevelled wardrobe.
"Isn't it about time you took this fella home?"
he asks with an accusing nod at Sid.
"I wish."
"You'll just have to sit her down and have that talk." I smile. We both know who he's talking about. Her is the reason I don't have Sid at home. But easier said than done, and this is a football we've kicked about over old ground many times. Rob's diplomatic enough to change the subject.
"Were you on call over the weekend?" he asks.
"No, Bryony had that pleasure. You're just back from leave, though, aren't you? Go anywhere nice?" Rob shrugs.
"One of my unpaid months."
"Ah, where were you this time?"
"The Sudan. The damned fighting started up again. 50 gunshot wounds last week."
I shake my head. "Christ, Rob, I take my hat off to you."
"Once you've seen what needs to be done, it's hard to say no."
He looks up at me, eyes slitting.
"You've never thought of VSO?
"I've thought about it," I say. And it's true. Whenever I see Rob, I think about it, only to file it away as soon as we say goodbye.
"I have all the connections you'd need in MSF if you ever decide to go. I have another mission scheduled for 9 months' time. You ought to come. Be happy to show you the ropes."
"Maybe," I say, because it's polite. But the truth is, any thoughts I've had about volunteering my skills abroad have been fleeting, elbowed quickly out of the way by work and holidays and house hunting. I try to recall what MSF stands for, and eventually it flashes into my head. Médecins sans frontières. Oui.
"Sid's looking so much better," Rob says, patting the dog's broad rump. "God, he was wild when I first saw him."
"He's doing well." My phone rings. It's the private clinic where I also do sessions. One of the secretaries there tells me a patient wants to talk to me about her surgery, and she's due in on my next list. I ask for the patient's number, but then, while she has me, the secretary asks about further clinic dates. I wave Rob an apology while I answer. Maisie rubs her thin body against my knee. Rob calls her to him and mouths,
"See you later, Jake,"
so as not to disturb me. I watch him go. Rob's a straight-up bloke and I admire him. He's an excellent surgeon, but I don't envy him. He and his wife, Faye, live in an unpretentious semi on the edge of the park. Faye works as a health visitor. He's told me more than once that the local schools are bloody good. There's never been any suggestion of him sending his kids for private education, and he doesn't believe in private practice. When he volunteers abroad, he goes to the worst places, the ones with the least facilities, the most in need of help. Though he goes as a general surgeon, he ends up doing obstetrics, orthopedics, plastics, you name it. The last place he went to, somewhere on the Syrian border, had no X-ray facilities at all. I don't understand how he does it, but he has all my respect. It must rub off on his kids because I know at least one of them is following in his footsteps. 20-year-old Harriet Eastman accompanied Rob on one of his mazy walks last September, wearing a t-shirt with Miseris Sucrere Disco, her med school motto, emblazoned across it. I knew what that meant because it's my and Rob's alma mater. I learn to care for the unfortunate is a laudable ethos. Needless to say, irreverent med student humour adulterated it into miserable suckers at the disco while I was there. Puerile, I know, but that's how I remember it. Yet Rob, God bless him, is a believer in the system. He also believes in giving back. It's something to aspire to. But not for me. Not yet. Too many rungs of the ladder to climb. The jogger is coming back again, looping the park. Difficult to know how old she is, but probably not much older than the missing Katie Leith. A little flicker of anxiety dances along a nerve plexus in my guts again. I do know Katie Leith as a colleague, albeit vaguely. But there's no denying that I'm probably also one of the last people to see her before she went missing. The police know that too. And today, after I've finished with Sid, they're going to be asking me all sorts of questions. Routine, I'm sure. I quell the flock of butterflies in my stomach that flutter up by putting in a little spurt of speed with Sid. He watches me run and bounds after me. As she passes us, the jogger smiles again.
Chapter 3. I get a text from the secretary with the patient's number, so I pull up. By the time I've read it, Rob and Maisie are 100 yards away, and Sid's onto the next set of smells, the jogger forgotten. There's no one around, so I let him off. My phone rings again. It's Sarah. It's 7:10 a.m. and she always knows where I am this time in the morning on a Tuesday. She'll be on the train. Times open on her iPad. FT still folded. Coffee, double shot cappuccino with oat milk, on the tray table in front of her. I left the house before she got up, and she'll be away in London until Thursday. This is how we live. Regimented, some might say. Some do say. But it's how we like it. At least, I thought we did.
Hi.
How's Sid this morning? Newspaper rustles.
Sid's fine. He says hello.
A lack of response and refusal to play my game tells me that Sarah, though expecting this affectation from me, finds it mildly irritating. Sarah doesn't like dogs, nor cats, nor animals in general. She's definitely allergic to cat dander, but with dogs, it's something else. Fear, possibly. It doesn't matter. I respect that. We both agreed that we would not have a dog in the house. That was the second thing in the unwritten contract we drew up when we moved in together. The first was that we did not want children. I can accept that. But when it comes to dogs, I need my fix. Hence my thrice weekly dates with Sid. Hence my blank stare when Rob Eastman jokingly suggests I need to sit Sarah down and have that talk.
Beautiful morning, I say.
It is. Jake, I forgot to tell you last night that I said we'd have a drink with Will and Chloe on Friday night.
Fait accompli.
Fine.
Oh, and I've left more brochures for Dot. There's one. You know the cottage on the edge of that farm? It's come down by 30. We ought to go over and look at it. I thought Saturday afternoon, and then maybe grab a late lunch at the Miller.
Sounds good. There's another rustle, and Sarah says, The papers are still full of your missing nurse.
And they would be.
Still no sign of her?
It's rhetorical. I listened to the early bulletin on the way to get Sid. The press have the bit between their speculative teeth.
Not according to the Times, Sarah says.
There's a pause. I visualize her taking a sip of coffee, lipstick leaving a mark on the reusable bamboo mug she uses to avoid an unnecessary cardboard cup.
When are you talking to the police? She asks after a swallow.
This morning, after 10.
Is that going to mess up your list?
A bit, but I'm starting early and I've got some help.
Good. Okay, have a good one and try not to kill too many patients, darling.
Gallows humour. She's learned how to dish it out. You do when you live with a surgeon.
See you Thursday, I say.
But she's already rung off.
Dot is our shorthand for Dorchester-on-Thames. 3 pubs, wisteria-strewn cottages and beautiful South Oxfordshire countryside. We've talked about moving for a year, and Dot is top of our list. It's 8 miles from Oxford and close to Didcot Station, which will cut Sarah's commute by quite a bit. It would be a great place for a dog, too. I quash that idea.
Sarah Barstow, that's her name, is a bright, beautiful, career-minded woman. I'm a lucky bloke. She's fully supportive of my volunteering as a dog walker, so long as she doesn't have to go anywhere near. I keep an old jacket, jeans, and sweatshirt in the garden shed, so she doesn't have to be exposed to them. And I take them to the laundrette once a fortnight when they get too mud-spattered and furry. Though I suspect Sid wouldn't mind if I never wash them again. I like dogs. We always had one when I was growing up. I enjoy their company. I love the feel of their fur and their unfettered joy at the sight of a ball. University, training, and career moves meant I was never in a position to own a dog. But now we're settled. I have more time. Sid is a four-legged compromise. As I said, I generally walk him 3 times a week. The easiest is a Saturday morning, because work doesn't impinge. When I'm on call, it might be difficult, but usually I can easily squeeze in an hour. Wednesday afternoons are the next best. That's when I theoretically have an SPA, supporting professional activity, afternoon. Of course, that ends up being more like 2 hours than a whole afternoon, but it means I can leave the hospital early. So I pick Sid up at 4, or a little earlier in the winter, while it's still light. And finally, there are Tuesday mornings like this one, when I get to pause for claws for 6:30 and drop Sid off an hour later. At 7:35 a.m., I bike back into town. On the way, I think again about Rob Eastman's approach to work, his choices. No chasing private practice, volunteering his service abroad. It sounds like an uncomplicated life, a simpler existence, much like a dog's. There's a lot to be said for that. How much fun would it be to swap lives with Sid for a day? I let my imagination ponder this imponderable for a while and then put it from my mind, because there are other things to consider within this construct. Much as I might enjoy chasing after a ball, Sid wouldn't thank me if he found himself being interviewed by the police about a missing girl.
Chapter 4. Detective Inspector Joanna Ridley is, by my estimation, a runner. She has a lean, almost gaunt look about her as she sits opposite appraising me. She's milk pale, makeup free, except perhaps for some eyelash thickener and a touch of shininess on her lips. Something hangs on a silver chain around her neck. Whatever it is, it's not on view under the primly done-up button of her white shirt. Her hair is dark and practically short. Her charcoal suit is creased and has a stain on the sleeve. Its ochre colour suggests ketchup or soup. I doubt it's blood. I know what blood looks like. I'd put her at a year or two younger than me, somewhere around her late 30s. But she could be older, because she looks tired. Pressures of the job have etched wavy lines in her forehead. It makes me wonder if there are children at home, just to add a little grist to the daily grind of police work. She listens and watches with cold, sharp, oxyacetylene eyes as her fellow officer, Detective Sergeant Ryan Oakes, asks the questions.
Did you speak to Katie Leith at all that evening, Mr. Thorne?
I shake my head.
No, I knew she was there, but then so were most of the nursing staff from the surgical unit. It was a good turnout. Oakes is younger, taller, with a footballer's build, evident even though he's sitting. Not enough upper body for a rugby player, I'd guess. Unlike his boss, there are no lines on his smooth, dark skin, and not even a hint of grey in his cropped hair. His eyes narrow. Why do you say that? You don't always get a huge turnout at leaving dues, but this was for one of the nursing sisters. They are usually well attended. So you know, Katie. I notice use of the present tense. It's reassuring. I do. Not well. She's only been on the unit a few months.
6, Oakes says.
Right, I say. I've come across her on ward rounds. The odd lecture I may have given. But not socially. No. Sister Morris's leaving due would have been the first time we'd ever been in a social gathering together. What about at Christmas time? No ward party? I bark out a laugh. They usually organise something. I pitch up for half an hour to show my face and leave. They can be dangerously boozy affairs. If she was there at the last one, I didn't see her.
She was, Oakes says.
What do you mean by dangerously boozy? Ridley asks. Her voice is even and cool and precise. I mean, people do things when they drink, things they sometimes regret, as I'm sure you know. Why would I know? Ridley's eyes bore into me. Crime is like medicine. Alcohol is a major contributor to workloads in both. She doesn't nod or smile. Hard case, this one. Have you ever done anything you regret after drinking? Oakes slits his eyes. It makes him look much younger than he already is. When I was younger, undoubtedly. Same as you have, I expect. What sort of... Oh, come on, I cut in. Realize I'm being impatient, so qualify it by adding, you know what I mean. I'm in a position of responsibility. I try to remain responsible when I'm with co-workers. Nothing worse than seeing all those inhibitions evaporate around you.
Nothing worse?
I don't comment. Ridley shifts in her chair and sits forward. You left the Duke of Wellington at what time, Mr. Thorne? She's not local. Her accent stretches the first vowel of the word time far too long. I shrug. I'd guess around 10:20.
And you went directly home?
Oakes again. I did. I had a list the following morning.
List?
Operating list. Surgery. And you parked where exactly? Ridley asks. One of the streets nearby. I think it was Backham. The pub car park was full. Ridley continues. CCTV shows Katie leaving the pub at 10:25 p.m. She was meant to be working the next day too. Her last sighting is her crossing the road opposite the pub. We can find no record of her calling a cab or Uber, but you did not see her leave. I shake my head. I'd have long gone by then. The DI has a habit of maintaining eye contact long after I've answered her question. Some people would find her intimidating. Some people say the same thing about me. Goes with the territory, I presume. Responsibility. Leading a team. Eventually, Ridley leans back. Oakes is reading his notes, preparing for his next question. I glance around. We're in a seminar room in the post-grad center. Tiled ceiling with sunken lights, white walls, laminated floor. Someone has drawn and labeled a brain on the flip chart in the corner. It's a soulless room. One I'm very familiar with. Ridley picks up on it. What normally happens in here? Lectures. C-pod meetings. Her brows furrow. What's that? Confidential inquiry into perioperative deaths. Sounds very secretive. It isn't. It's where we come to confess our sins. Where the pathologists criticize our skills or lack thereof if one of our patients dies. My attempt at lightening the mood elicits only a grimace. Oakes has found his next question. He looks relieved.
And what time did you get home?
It's 20 minutes from Jericho, where the Duke of Wellington is, to Headington, so somewhere around 10:45, I think.
Can someone confirm that?
My partner was at home, but she was in bed. I can't remember if my arriving back disturbed her. You'd have to ask her. I should have said that I doubt I would have disturbed her, since we sleep in separate rooms during the week.
Sarah commutes to London, to a plush office in the city. The train takes an hour, and she's on the 7 a.m. most days, unless she stays over. And when I'm on call, I might not be home until late, or even have to go in at some silly hour. We've become adept at not disturbing one another. Weekends we shared a bed. Sarah and I are practical people.
We may well do that, Mr. Thorne.
Oakes says it primly.
I can give you her number.
A nod.
That would be helpful.
He pushes a notepad towards me, and I write down Sarah's number. It's an untidy scrawl. But contrary to what people think, there isn't a course on bad handwriting at medical school. It's more about impatience, the waste of time having to put pen to paper. Oakes looks at it and offers up a grateful smile.
I think that's about all we need for now.
He glances across at Ridley, who nods. It's a small movement, tiny. Oakes shuts his notebook.
Thanks for coming across so promptly, Mr. Thorne. We're doing what we can to piece together Katie's movements. We appreciate your cooperation.
Of course. Anything I can do. You have my secretary's number, I take it. Oakes nods.
Okay, so you know how to find me if there is anything else.
I get up and push back from the pale wooden table they've set up for interviews. There's been a police presence at the hospital for days. All entirely understandable, under the circumstances. I stand up to take my leave, but hesitate.
And you have no idea what's happened to her? I ask.
Ridley gives me the stock answer. From her, it sounds like a challenge.
We're pursuing several lines of inquiry.
I shake my head.
It's awful. You hear about this sort of thing in the news, but you never think it could happen to someone you know. The whole hospital, nursing staff especially, is in shock.
It's a difficult time for everyone, Oakes says. Ridley adds,
but someone must know something.
Oakes glances at her before a final.
We'll find her, don't you worry.
Chapter 5. I leave the room and head to the cafe in post-grad to feed my caffeine habit. I nod to a few people, but I'm thinking of D.I. Ridley. The way she watched my face as I answered Oakes's questions. She was looking for something. A flaring of nostrils, a slide away of eye contact. Some bullshit pop psych physical indicator of a lie. But two can play at that observational game. D.I. Ridley had a scar over a lumpy wrist bone, an enlarged distal ulnar styloid. I'd say a nasty wrist fracture that needed pins or a plate. Maybe she's a skier. Or a snowboarder. It's a typical injury. All that from a 1-inch scar. I catch myself. Okay, so I found her a little intimidating. But that good cop, bad cop setup is designed for exactly that, I'd say. And who doesn't get a little anxious when talking to the police? Especially about a girl who's been missing for 4 days. That brings my mind around to Katie Leith. I'd noticed her at Sister Morris's do. Who wouldn't have? Professionally, as a consultant on the unit, I'm not supposed to look twice. And at work, I don't. But I have blood coursing through my veins. And some of my colleagues, not all, even believe it's warm. Katie is mid-20s, blonde, and at the Duke of Wellington was in a short dress and heels, fully made up and delightful. Like many of the others, and yet not quite, because Katie stood out. Something about the way she held herself, or the big eyes and the full mouth and the firm limbs. She might even have been one of these kids who'd had a boob job. Personally, I think it's criminal to even offer it at that age, but then I'm not raking it in as a plastic surgeon. Amazing what the filthy lucre does to ethics. Yet it wasn't only me who noticed. She drew admiring stares, and not just from the men. I check myself, opt for the only saying justification with my conscience. Not that I was in any way being lecherous. At least, I didn't think so. Women can dress however they like, express their sexuality however they like. My body, my closet, my rules. I know all that. Sarah makes sure I do. Yet, like most men, it always confuses me when women choose to show off their physical attributes and then not expect people to look. All a part of being young and feeling good about yourself, is my understanding. As long as it is just looking, then there's no harm done. Peachey knew what she was doing and probably felt great about herself. If you look like that, why not? She came across as very confident and aware and capable. She was all of those things as a nurse. Besides, I'm only saying, or rather thinking, all of these things because I'm in a relationship with a beautiful partner, aren't I? And even more besides, who the hell am I trying to kid? Peachey was way too young for, well, for anything. But that's the thing about social gatherings linked to work. I find it weirdly disorientating to mingle with colleagues no longer camouflaged by the chrysalis of gender-neutral NHS uniforms. The vast majority scrub up really well. It's often quite a shock, though a very pleasant one, to see what butterflies they transform into. Everyone there had made an effort to say goodbye to one of their own, and that's always a cause for celebration in this business. When someone completes the obstacle course and reaches 40-plus years of service without going mad or burning out, definitely time to get out the bunting, or shots, as was obvious on many tables. There was even a DJ. You can always bank on NHS staff needing minimal excuse for a knees-up. Of course, I'd never say any of this anti-woke, non-PC stuff to D.I. Ridley. If I ever did, I imagine green lasers shooting from her eyes instantly aimed at cutting me in half, like that scene from the Bond film with Sean Connery strapped to a table. Ouch. I order a cappuccino to take away and wait for it at the end of the counter. Behind me, people sit at tables, reading, talking. It's a light, airy space courtesy of a 2 million conversion project in the first decade of the new century. A recognition of the fact that education remains a vital cog in this university city, even in its hospitals. To distract my mind from thoughts of poor Peachey, I let my eyes drift. Inspirational quotes written in original old fonts, blown up and framed, hang in spaces on the walls. I can see one from where I stand. It's the one that always appears in my eyeline when I wait at the counter. The physician must have two special objects in view with regard to disease, namely to do good or to do no harm. It's Hippocrates, his Epidemics Book 1. I can quote the clip verbatim because I've read it so many times, which says a lot more about the amount of coffee I drink than it does about any obsession with medical morals. Okay, as a launching off point for discussions on medical ethics, it's a doozy. Euthanasia, abortion, informed consent, they all start right there with the big H. The original Hippocratic Oath specifies, I will utterly reject harm and mischief. These days it sounds more like a Harry Potter quote than an ancient text. It's commonly misquoted as, first, do no harm. That has a better book and film title ring to it, but the interpretation on the wall is close enough. Still, it's all a bit too kitsch for my liking. All a bit too old hat. Just like Miseris succurrere disco. And as for Hippocrates, someone thinks it'll do no harm in these days of web-based learning, whistleblowing and abuse of privilege to remind us all of ancient maxims as we snatch a fresh cup of Arabica. Even if the misplaced nobility and altruistic simplicity of 2,500 years ago has little relevance in today's modern society, now we have targets to meet, budgets to not overspend, drugs to invent and make profits from. I confine D.I. Ridley, D.S. Oakes, Peachey Leith and the merits of Hippocrates to the mental drawer marked someone else's problem. I need to compartmentalize. I have work to do, and for that I need to apply myself. I head up to the main theatres, keen to get back and find out how Melvin Prosser is getting on. He's been asleep on the operating table for a good hour. Time I paid my respects. I snap a lid on my coffee cup, to drink as I walk. I've forgotten my bamboo cup. Sarah would be furious. On the way back to theatre, I phone my private patient. She wants to know if she has to take off all her nail varnish before she has her surgery. I tell her no, that I'm sure that it'll be okay to leave things as they are. Chapter 6. With Thorn gone, Inspector Ridley let the interview percolate in her head. She knew her silence drove Ryan Oakes mad. He wanted to pull things apart immediately, but she preferred a period of reflection before analysis. But Oakes was restless. He put a mug of tea down on the desk in front of his boss, and, holding his own while stirring in 2 spoonfuls of sugar, walked over to the flip chart on one side of the room. Underneath the drawn brain on a separate sheet, someone had drawn an enlarged ECG trace. A weird hillscape with one large spike, all neatly labelled with a P, Q, R, S, and T. "He's a real charmer, isn't he?" Oakes spoke to the chart, but Joanna Ridley knew he was talking to her.
"As in snake, you mean?"
Oakes swiveled around, frowning. "First, that doesn't work at all as an analogy, other than you wanting to equate the bloke unflatteringly to some reptile. And second, isn't that a bit harsh? I mean, it's not like you to be judgmental." He raised the mug to his lips to hide a smile, but it was there, visible in his eyes over the rim. The sardonic glint that let her know how much her statement epitomized the sort of response he had expected.
"Much too sure of himself, if you ask me."
What she didn't add was that he'd been younger than she'd expected, and fitter, in an exercise sense. He'd worn a suit that must have been 3 times more expensive than the off-the-shelf special Ryan wore every day. Thorn wore his dark hair cut short, and he'd had small, neat features and eyes that almost danced with sharpness. She hadn't liked him. But then she didn't like anyone she'd had to interview in an investigation, on principle. Sometimes, after elimination, she might consider someone as reasonably okay, but not at a first meeting. She didn't allow it. Oakes was having none of it, though.
"I'd have said more confidence than swagger. And being sure means nothing. He's a surgeon. They have to have a bit of an ego to get where they are, don't they? Goes with the label."
Oakes walked over to a table under a window where someone had laid on hot water, tea bags and granulated coffee, the kind that hardened with exposure into a stale, solid mass that had to be broken up by poking a spoon through the crust, and a plate of biscuits. He picked one up and dunked it in his mug before adding, "The bloke that did my snip was brilliant. Hands like shovels, but I didn't feel a thing. Told rude jokes all the way through. Exactly what you want with your tackle on display." Ridley pursed her lips, one of her default expressions. "Spare me the banter and the gory details. What I'm saying is that surgeons are hardly ever wilting flowers. They're usually at the top of their game." "So you agree he's confident, but not arrogant enough to abduct a young girl, hide her away and then play poker with the police at an interview?" Ridley asked.
"Yes, I mean, no. Where's his motive, for starters?"
She didn't answer because, as yet, she hadn't got one for Thorne. She looked at the file in front of her. She'd asked for brief summaries of everyone they were looking at. Just the basics. Address, background, previous convictions. Thorne's file was very sparse. He had no previous, but there was some information.
"He's good at his job. Growing private practice. 9 out of 10 stars on bestdocs.com. Sits on ethics committees, lectures. In other words, a narcissist."
The biscuit on its way back for a second dunk stopped 3 inches from the surface of the tea in Oakes's hand.
"Wow, that's pretty scathing, even for you."
"Yes. Well, he looked guilty of something."
Oakes shook his head.
"You say that about everyone, and I'm usually right. Someone will know something. They always do."
"An unpaid parking ticket doesn't make you a sexual predator."
"You asked me what I thought," Ridley said, and she guessed it would be what others thought too.
Gone were the days when being a doctor guaranteed probity. They were human and stuffed with all the psychological frailties that went with the label, and having a certain social standing meant power there to use or abuse. She never allowed status to affect her judgment, especially not in cases like this. High flyer though he might be, Thorne remained very much on her radar because he was male, knew the misper, and was in the vicinity when Katie Leith was last seen. It was early days, but everyone linked to the case knew that with each hour that passed, the chance of finding Katie alive diminished, like a candle slowly burning down until, with a sputter, it finally extinguishes. In Thorne's case, Ridley sensed this would not be the last time they'd do the Q&A pasodoble together across a desk. When she looked up, Oakes was staring at her. "I know that look," he said. "Biscuit?"
"No, thank you."
She would have loved one, but today was a no-carb day. She'd eaten some nuts earlier on, and there'd be half an avocado for lunch. She had a half marathon looming in 5 weeks and was way behind schedule, thanks to this damned case. Knowing it made her cranky. "And no more for you either."
"It's the one perk of the job," Oakes protested in a whine. "I need that soggy biscuity comfort to get through this."
He waved a digestive toting hand.
"I hate bloody hospitals." "I told Nola I'd watch your snacking."
Oakes feigned offence.
"Since when are you and Nola besties?"
Oakes's significant other was a sergeant in traffic. She and Ridley sweated at the same gym.
"We share mutual interests, one of which is the size of your gut. I'm not having her blaming me for your first stroke."
"Harsh, harsh, harsh," Oakes said.
But he put down the second biscuit.
"Right," Ridley turned back to her files. "Who's next?"
Chapter 7. I dress in scrubs in the changing room. The space smells faintly of feet and sweat. I tie on a blue scrub cap and step out into the theatre corridor. Once across this threshold, it's fancy dress only. We're in Theatre 4 this morning, as usual. I nod to a couple of orthopaedic colleagues and an ENT surgeon following a trolley bearing a patient with bandages over his, or is it her, nose. Everyone walks with purpose, like ants in a nest. Operating theatre suites are not environments where anyone dawdles. I enter Theatre 4 through the anaesthetic room. White walls, ceiling-mounted lights, the cloying smell of blood and iodine. I'm at home here. There are 7 people in the room, not including our patient, Mr. Prosser, who is on the table, mercifully unaware of anything and everything that is going on around him. Everyone is in scrubs, but 3 of the 7 are gowned up. A diminutive Filipino called Flory, short for Flordeliza, who is the scrub nurse. A third-year surgical trainee called Sonia Goyle, the scrub assistant. And my fellow, Mr. Patrick Connor, who has 2 feet of Mr. Prosser's intestine on a wet towel outside his abdomen. Everyone, bar Patrick and Mr. Prosser, looks up as I enter.
"They didn't arrest you then?"
The voice that delivers this irreverent, tasteless remark belongs to a man sitting at the head end of the table, next to an anaesthetic machine, throwing out pulses and beeps. Dr. Ashish Hegde has worked with me since I became a consultant almost 5 years ago. Hegde is a Goan surname, but Ashish has a Surrey accent as befitting someone born and bred in that county and who follows their cricket team and the Indian national team avidly. He does not have many graces, but the one he does have that saves him is the fact that he's a bloody good anaesthetist.
"That's uncalled for," I say, shaking my head. Indeed, his comment has triggered a couple of raised eyebrows from both the medical student who stands back against the wall and a second nurse who is running for the case. Ashish grins. "I'm talking about previous offences, obviously." I ignore him and step forward. I slide up a mask to cover my mouth and nose and peer into the operating field over Sonia's shoulder. Mr. Prosser is a 33-year-old Crohn's disease patient with worsening symptoms. Workup showed that he had multiple ileal skip strictures and adhesions from episodes of recurrent inflammation. He's been heading for total bowel obstruction for weeks. That's why we are all here. Crohn's is an unpleasant disease.
"How are you getting on?" I ask.
It's an innocent enough question, but Patrick tenses immediately and looks up. The little pillows of fat just above the rim of his mask are flushed from stress. Below us, pink bowel glistens.
"As you thought,
Patrick says. Most of the stricture was adjacent to the appendix, but all was healthy proximal to that. I've resected almost a foot.
How the hell is he going to walk?
Ashish quips. I ignore him and swing around. Florrie picks up a 10-inch mass of ruffled and scarred bowel from a stainless steel bowl. Patrick has opened the intestine for inspection. The strictures and ulcers are obvious. I look up at the med student.
You've seen this?
He nods. It's a good example, I say. Very typical. Then I turn back to the coils of bowel on the towels. Patrick has used a staple gun to cut the intestinal ends and sewn and stapled a 3-inch segment together lengthwise in a side-to-side anastomosis so that a large open junction can function. The function of the junction is something the team in Theatre 4 has heard me emphasize many times. It's with significant restraint that I don't repeat it now.
You're oversewing, I ask.
About to begin. I look at the clock. It's almost 11 a.m. We should have finished this by now.
I had a bleeder.
I nod. Patrick is a competent surgeon, but he's slow. Speed will come with experience. But for now, time is not his friend. There's more to get through, and my interlude with the police has been an unnecessary distraction.
Okay, I say. I'll scrub and finish off. Get some coffee. Take Alex, the med student, and check in on Mrs. Voden, our hepatectomy from yesterday. There's a gallbladder after this, and...
I'd like to finish this case, Patrick says.
It comes out oddly petulant. Not everyone oversews the staple lines to the extent that I insist he does. But this isn't his decision. It's mine.
This looks like a nice job, but I'll finish up. Go and see Mrs. Voden.
I narrowly avoid adding, there's a good lad. Patrick is only a few years my junior and has taken his time to climb the ladder. He, much more so than me, is acutely aware of the lack of difference in age. But there is no more argument. I walk to the prep room and begin scrubbing. By the time I get back to the table, Patrick is gone.
Florrie holds up a mounted 3-0 absorbable suture on a needle driver. I take it and start working. There's music playing. Nothing pretentious like jazz. The idea is to promote a relaxed, efficient atmosphere, not impinge recherche tastes onto a captive audience. So we have smooth extra. Old school hits that Sonia has never heard of, but I know them all. Thanks to my parents' insistence on having music throughout the house when I was growing up. While chairman of the board pleads ironically for us to give them just a little more time, I make Sonia run through the blood supply to the mid-gut. She's done her homework and we go over what's needed for good anastomosis. This is how teaching should be, the way I like to do it. Hands-on. We finish up quickly and hand Mr. Prosser over to Ashish and recovery. The laparoscopic cholecystectomy that follows goes quickly and well. We get through the list by 12:40. Not bad. Afterwards, in the changing room, Ashish is a tad more conciliatory in his questioning about the police. He has a restless build, long body and short legs. Together with the beard he now sports, he wouldn't look out of place in the foothills of the Hindu Kush, toting a rifle astride a horse. I've told him this several times, and it always ends up with him striking a pose and shouting a battle cry. Not that he's ever been to the Himalayas, nor ridden a horse. But today we stay away from the mild, reciprocal, racist banter. I'm just a privileged white boy. Leave your top hat in Eton, did you, Thorn? Even though I've never been to Eton except to look at the gates when I went on a school trip in Windsor on a bus. We sometimes, and ridiculously, indulge in. Never do it in front of other staff members, of course, for fear of injuring PC sensibilities. Though Ashish struggles with that. He's even more anti-woke than I am. Today, however, Ashish wants information.
What did they ask you?
If I saw Katie at Sister Morris's leaving bash. If I saw her leave Sister Morris's leaving bash. Ashish nods. The answer was yes and no.
I'm glad I wasn't there.
Ashish throws his scrubs into an overflowing laundry basket and stands in his underwear. He needs to think about a 5-2 diet. But 4 days with no trace. He shakes his head.
I have a cousin in the Met. He says it doesn't sound good.
Her being missing for that long.
I nod and slip on my suit trousers, trying not to think of what not sounding good actually implies.
Oh, and you were a bit harsh with young Patrick. He did good.
Handled the bleeder very competently.
He is competent. But if you have 5 on the list and 3.5 hours to finish it, you can't afford to spend half your allocated time on one case. He needs to understand that. Because that'll mean cancellations, and I'm buggered if I'm going to tell someone we can't do their operation because Patrick's slow in sewing up.
Ashish shakes his head.
But he thinks you think he's incompetent. You could tell from his eyes, that hangdog look. He was humiliated in front of Sonia. He needs to toughen up a bit and speed up even more. He'll be me in another couple of years. He needs to see the big picture.
So it's not because you're a control freak then?
Ashish is pushing my buttons, and he knows it.
No.
No, you're not a control freak, or no, the reason you're hard on Patrick has nothing to do with you being a control freak.
Jesus, how many coffees have you had today?
Just the 3. Ashish grins. He pulls on fresh scrubs. That's one of the big pluses of being an anaesthetist. You get to play fancy dress for far longer. I sigh. I'm not here to be the trainee's mother or their friend. I'm here to make sure they're safe to be let out into the world. End of.
I think Patrick's getting that message loud and clear, Jake.
Good.
So he should.
But you are a control freak. You know that.
He pinches some belly fat.
Nice, I say.
Hey, I'm off the cakes. And not a moment too soon, may I say.
It's fine for you cyclists with your fancy bikes. I have one you could borrow, I offer.
Nah, senior squash. That's my thing.
Going back to it now that the kids are older.
I hope you have an ECG before you start. Is there a defibrillator on the court?
Very funny. When I come to visit you in prison, I'll be lithe and sinewy.
I throw a bunched up scrub shirt at him. He ducks, but his reflexes are not that good. Like I said, he should consider shedding a few pounds, or he's never going to learn how to shoot that rifle in the high passes.
Chapter 8. Sarah's a consultant too, only not of the medical type. Her skills were learned in the city, working her way up from sales through capital markets and regulations, even a spell in mergers and acquisitions. She's freelance now, called in by a variety of big and not-so-big banks and institutions to troubleshoot and deliver projects. She's been in Canary Wharf for the last 6 months, with at least another 4 to go on her current little jolly. Her term, not mine, delivered with steely irony and a grimace. Something to do with outsourcing a big chunk of their business to Mumbai, from what I can recall. I don't pretend to understand it. Sarah has given up expecting me to. Mondays she works from home. Tuesday she commutes. Wednesday she stays up for 2 nights with her old college friend Jessica, who has a flat in Newington Green. That way Sarah can get away lunchtime on Fridays and be back in Oxford mid-afternoon. Obviously, all of that is only possible because we have no children. Work keeps us busy. I get home before Sarah on Tuesdays, and so I prepare dinner. She's a vegetarian. I'm not. It's an easy negotiation when we eat out, but at home, I am happy to compromise. Partly because some part of me believes it may do me good not to eat too much red meat. I've read the studies. I know that the methodologies used use lab conditions and extremes of intake way beyond the normal human diet. Even so, removing tumors from people's colons is a big part of what I do. As such, I have a healthy respect for not overdoing anything, even in the slightest bit risky. The heme of red meat included. I hear myself thinking these thoughts and smile. All empirical. Not a very scientific approach. But what the hell? Tonight is one of the 2 on our 5-2 regimens. We don't go mad, not like some, but we both think it has benefits. Tonight we're having roast cod with broccoli, dusted with almonds and pecans. I'm throwing together a rocket and pomegranate side salad for its polyphenols and for added pretentiousness. When I was growing up, it would have been fish fingers and chips.
Sarah arrives home at just after 6:15. I'm in the kitchen in an apron. She puts her briefcase down in the hall, sings out, "Hi," and walks across the tiled floor to kiss me on the cheek. She has one eye on the food. "Mmm," she says. "Looks delish." "As do you," I reply. She lets out a snorted, "Ha," but she's already walking away, keen to get out of her working clothes. I glimpse bare calves above 3-inch heels with red soles. She loves her Louboutins. And with calves like she has, why not? She trots up the stairs, and I can hear the squeaking boards in her bedroom. Sometimes she'll shower before we eat, to get the grime out. I get on with laying the table. There's something reassuring about this little routine of ours, something very satisfying about these few moments of domestic intercourse that flows deep into my soul. It's welcoming, as satiating as thick, dark chocolate. At least it has been. And yes, I know it sounds smug, but then it's what people, normal people, strive for, isn't it? A relationship, enough money to eat, somewhere to live where you can pull up the drawbridge and keep the wild world away. While I put down placemats and cutlery, I ponder this self-awareness and chide myself for not being able to accept it for what it is. I look around at the kitchen. It's at odds with the rest of the house, which is all beams and stone fireplaces. Here, an existing extension has been converted into a small but usable space with lots of light coming in from the tiny back garden. The worktops are polished concrete, the cupboards elm and modern, the type that glide shut on their own when you push them with your hip. An ever-hot oozes warmth and keeps the place cozy. Upstairs, there are 2 bedrooms and a bathroom, and a study with a glass-topped table and a Mac for when Sarah works from home. Okay, it's not big enough for what Sarah wants to do to it, but it's ours. We've even managed, between us, to pay off all but 20% of the mortgage. We've been lucky. When my mind strays to Sarah upstairs, probably in her underwear by now, I know I have. But then, everyone's luck runs out eventually. I find the virgin olive oil and the balsamic vinegar, put them on the table. Then I cut the pomegranate in half and spoon out the lush red seeds. Sarah and I met on top of a hill in New Zealand. I'd gone out after I qualified and got a job in Auckland for 6 months. Spread my wings after 5 years of grind to get my degrees. Sarah was with Jessica, backpacking. We were on the North Island, Mount Maunganui. It was windy. We trekked up the lava dome separately, unaware of each other's existence. On top of the mount, Jessica had something in her eye, and I, the doctor, casually wandering past, snapping photos of the cruise ships on one side and the beach on the other, offered to take a look. I took out her folded contact lens with a clean tissue. Jessica's short-sightedness was the start of it all. She's never let me forget it. "You're not the first person to look into my eyes and see only Sarah, Jake." That self-deprecation came with the suggestion that she was the less attractive of the two of them. They were both in their early 20s, tanned from walking all over New Zealand, bare-limbed and fit. But she is right. It was only Sarah that I truly saw on that hill. What followed was a relationship tested by separation. Sarah's career was London-centric, while mine, thanks to deanery training, took me to Stoke Mandeville and Berkshire. But when the chance came for a fellowship in California, I took it. Against the odds, we had survived it all. When I got the job back in Oxford, Sarah gave up her contract with the business consultancy firm she'd worked with for 3 years and became freelance. We pooled our resources for a deposit on the house. Sedgewood is, a tiny detached cottage with added-on reception rooms on Quarry Hollow. The previous owners spent a lot of money modernizing it, so there was not much to do. Nothing, in fact. We bought it as an investment as much as a place to live. Sandstone walls made up the house and enclosed the garden. The windows are casements, modern but small, with bars to represent the tiny squares that would have all been individual panes to begin with.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.